can't help but think of the governor without thinking of his dad. John Greg McMaster was one of the first individuals that I had the pleasure of meeting when I started my work in Columbia. Words don't express the type of individual, fine gentleman, great character that his dad was. And having observed the governor in his work, he certainly follows in the footsteps of his dad. And I know your dad would be very proud of you today. I was thinking about the governor. He got his degree at Carolina and went on and got his law degree. And the first job, another education that he got, was actually working for U.S. Senator for Strom Thurmond. And he was a couple, two or three years before me getting to Washington. I worked up there part of the summer, but he was a legislative aide, and we were just talking about what a great senator he was, and I'm sure it was a tremendous education opportunity to work for Senator Thurmond back in those days. The governor then, in 1981, was appointed by President Ronald Reagan to be the U.S. Attorney for the state of South Carolina District. Matter of fact, he has the distinction of being the first U.S. Attorney that was appointed by President Reagan for right here in South Carolina. And I think, again, that's a great tribute to our governor and the high regard the president had upon him. Then he served the state of South Carolina for 2 years as the state attorney general. He was standing steadfast for law enforcement, for prosecution. He dedicated his years of service and a lot of different things that expanded the statewide grand jury, a lot of things that have served and continue to serve the state of South Carolina extremely well. And then I guess it was in 2014 that he was elected to the lieutenant governor for the state of South Carolina. And so he had the opportunity to preside over the Senate of the state of South Carolina for 2 years. And again, I just want to make an observation there. He did it with fairness and accuracy based on the rules and the law. And again, it was another affirmation to me of the character and the dedication this man has to the state of South Carolina. Then it was on January 24th, just a little bit over a year ago of last year, 2017, that I had the opportunity, along with Representative Whitmire, to stand there in the lobby of the State House and to watch an orderly transfer of authority from Governor Haley to Governor McMaster as he became the 117th governor of the state of South Carolina on January 24th of 2017. He and his wife Peggy, who I have the pleasure of knowing as well, they have two adult children. They're members of First Presbyterian Church there in Columbia, a great South Carolinian. We're honored tonight to have with us, and we're asking that you join in a great Oconee County welcome for the governor of the state of South Carolina, my friend, Henry McMaster.
I've been to, I think, just one so far. But it is, that's a great organization, and what you're doing here is recognizing the importance of young people. And I'll tell you, we got to teach the young people something, because a lot of them not learning what it's saying, what it's supposed to be. But I'll save that subject for another day, but Tom, thank you for that wonderful introduction. And, my daddy passed away, and he was almost 101 in just about 3 weeks, called 101. Tried his last case, Alex. My daddy and Alex's daddy, Neil McCauley, were great friends at First Presbyterian Church. Tried his last case at 93-1 at Georgia Trial. He finally closed the office up at 99, and he was with us right till the end. But I appreciate you, Tom. You thought very highly of you. And I got to tell you all a little story. I was on the way up to the Republican National Convention in 2016 in Cleveland. I was going to the Republican Convention because I'm a Republican. Some of you may not be. That's typically the way you do it. If you're a Republican, you go to the Republican Convention. So there I was, and I said to Peggy, my wife said, Peggy, did you ever in your wildest dream see your husband, Henry, nominating Donald Trump for president? She said, Henry, I hate to tell you, I never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. but I did, and they tell me I was the first elected official in the country to endorse Mr. Trump at the time, and it was lonely. And I got to promise you, when I made that step, with all my friends in Columbia, I became a total moron. Right then. But on election day, I was a certified genius. I said, how did you know? I said, well, I didn't know. You never know in politics. But politics is a great thing. But I want to tell you all, being invited to be here with this group of lawmen and veterans is a reminder to me as I look at you about where the real strength of your country is. And we watch on television, I swear I get so tired of watching those people yapping and fussing and turning everything inside out. Amen. And you wonder where in the world is the country going. But then you come and you see a group like you. And you can't be a yapping, crazy, a liberal, theoretical type of person if you've been in a war or you've been in law enforcement. I mean, that you get right down to the real life in understanding about what makes the world important, what makes strong people. And so I appreciate you. And I want to remind the young people that a lot of us get up in the morning and put on a tie and put on a nice shirt with no wrinkles in it. These men and women in law enforcement get up in the morning and put on a bulletproof vest and don't know if it's going to stop that bullet or not that day, whether it's going around it or not. And you can imagine the same thing for those in the military service. They don't know when they're going to go, and they don't know when they're going to come back. So this is real life. This is the real thing. And we stand here and look at this flag. I issued a proclamation the other day and asked everybody to stand up for the flag. I guarantee you that everybody in this room, when that national anthem is played, stand up and put your hand over your heart. And that's for good reason. I think the young people don't realize, so many of them, and some of them that are getting a little older, don't realize how many people had to fight and die for us to have what we have right here. They can't fathom it. Columbia, not far from Fort Jackson, and we could hear them counting off in the morning. We could hear reveling. We could hear taps. And I've always had great admiration for the military, and I've served 6 years in the Army Reserve. And one mistake, we all make mistakes. We look back. I was those meetings on the weekend. It never came at the right time. Never did. Of course, nothing ever does come at the right time. It seems like. But I wish that I had the opportunity to stay in and have directed the commission as a captain. I sure wish I had done that. So I would recommend to you young people, think about it real strong. Law enforcement, and the military. It just doesn't get any more respectable, any more meaningful, or any more important than that. So I urge you to consider that. Part of my job as governor is to try to recognize those kinds of things and to promote those sorts of things and to make things better for the people in our state. And I'll tell you just briefly, ladies and gentlemen, we have got the best place to live in the whole world. And I know that because as 8 years as Attorney General, I got to meet a lot of people coming from other states. And 2 years as Lieutenant Governor, I got to meet a whole other group of people from other states and other countries. And in the last year as governor, I've seen people from all over the world. And they all are saying the same thing. They all tell me there's no place else that they have ever been like South Carolina. So why is that? This is, I will quote the chairman of BMW on the 25th anniversary of the BMW plant in Greer, where, by the way, today they are producing a brand new vehicle every 61.7 seconds. That's right. Every 61.7 seconds a new BMW rolls off the line. They are cooking. And we have 120 German factories or businesses in South Carolina, 180 from Japan, and I met some today that are coming in. They will bring about $1 billion in. We've had in the last, this last year, 2017, we had almost $5 billion of capital investment in our state. 17,000 new jobs just in 1 year. But the problem, we're running into a problem because we can't supply the people fast enough. We've got the raw material. We've got police people who are smart, they believe in duty, they're strong, they're honest, they keep their word, but you have to have skills to work in these plants. Now, it's not like it used to be. It used to be you just show up and you do something and it didn't require a whole lot of skill, it required some stamina. But today, they don't have toolboxes in these plants. They have computers, they have laptops, they have tablets. You can wear a tuxedo and go to work in these places. It is different, but unfortunately, reality has not caught up with a lot of the parents who still want their children to get a four-year degree in French literature. But I tell you what, they don't speak French in these big plants. What they do is they speak the money, and they pay well, they're a respectable job, and those are the jobs of the future. We are lucky in South Carolina. Why do I say we? Because in 1961, we started with the best technical college system in the United States. And Tom and Bill, it has, because of leadership in the General Assembly and in the communities, those things have grown, they're getting stronger. And we're the only state in the country that will send a team from a technical college to somewhere across the ocean and look at their plant and see what it takes to work that machinery, and then come over here and have a course designed in our technical college system where we can train our people to work that. But the problem is they're not moving fast enough. So what I'm trying to do as your governor is to see that we have a dual credit opportunities in the high schools and the technical colleges, that we have scholarships, although technical college costs a third or a quarter as much as it does to go to a regular four-year school. Some people still don't have the money, so we're going to help provide some scholarships. But ladies and gentlemen, we have young people today that are smart, but they want to work with their brains and their hands. And if they go to that technical college, they can start on it and getting credits while they're in high school. We're going to develop that all around the state. They can start, they can go in 2 years, they can come out and get a job anywhere in South Carolina. We got 60,000 jobs looking for people right now. In the trades, in HVAC, in plumbers, and carpenters. You know that these long-distance truck drivers today can make up $90,000 or $100,000 a year? There was one story of a young fellow who was down on his luck. Somebody took him under his wing. He got his GED. That led him into, I think it was Midlands Tech in Columbia. And in 2 years, he had an associate's degree and a certificate in welding. And he went to work for about $75,000 a year. And then he decided he'd go back and get a certificate in nuclear welding. And he came out and he bumped up to about 90 to 95 thousand. And that's, you got young people can do that. They can do that, go to work, start building a family, buy a house, and then they, if they want to finish up and get a 4-year degree, which allow them to move on up in management, they can do it online with a lot of our schools. I mean, we've got so much promise here. It's puts a lot of other states to shame. But what I want to do is be sure that our young people stay here. And I know what I'm for. I want more paychecks, and I want them to all be bigger. Bigger paychecks and more of them. So I have proposed to the General Assembly that would be the House and the Senate. We're going to cut taxes. Anyone who is a retired law enforcement officer, now or later, if you're law enforcement, if you're a commissioned officer, that is a peace officer in prison, or a military, a veteran, a law enforcement officer, fireman, any of those where you have a commission, then there's no income tax on your retirement pay. No. And that includes federal officials, and that includes people that move into the state. And what'll that do? Besides letting people keep their money, and if they made it, they ought to keep it. It does not belong to the government. What does that do? That helps retain people. It helps recruit people, and of course, it helps the retirees when they retire. They don't have to pay income tax on that. And also, what I want to do is to reduce the income tax across the board, period, on all South Carolinians by cutting it 15%. The maximum now is 7%. Only 5 years, I want to take it down to 6. That is a 15% income tax. The first year would be $139 million. After 5 years, it would be $2.2 billion. We want to keep that in the people's pockets and let the men and women who earned it spend their own money, decide when, how they want to spend it. And we've worked it out, calculated it out. The government can go right along just fine without that money. And my plan is to get them lower and lower and lower. And why I want to do that? Because I have seen how it works. I'm old enough to remember when Jack Kennedy was president and he cut taxes and the liberals squat and the economy went up. More people had jobs, more people making money. You know what happens when people have jobs and they're making money? Crime goes down, drug usage goes down, marriages go up, divorces go down, everything gets better, education gets better, we got more money. The biggest enemy of education is poverty. The biggest enemy of education is poverty. And if we can bring the people up, let them keep their own money, get them good jobs, have them available for them, y'all, we can take off. There's nothing stopping us except a few votes at the state house to see to it that we get this done. I'm not making this up. This is, say what? Yeah, they listening. Y'all can't see them, but they listening up. Passing a law is the easiest thing that you just pass a law. It's not like you got to run a mile. It's not like you got to win a quiz. You just pass the law. You pass the law and let the people keep their money. This economy right now will take off. It'll be like a rocket. We are already way ahead of the other states. They're already looking at us and wanting to know what are they doing in South Carolina. Charleston, South Carolina has been the number one tourist destination in the country year after year, and the number one tourist destination in the world several times. Greenville got added to the list just the other day. People are discovering South Carolina. But back to that chairman of BMW, you know what he told us? And I heard the same thing, the same words from some others. Said South Carolina is a handshake state. When someone from South Carolina gives you their word and shakes your hand, you can count. They say it's the only one. And they also say they were shocked walking down the street of a little town and a lady came by and said, good morning, looked them right in the eye. Wrong with her. And then everybody they ran into was doing the same thing and opening the door for them and all that sort of stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, that doesn't happen everywhere, but it happens here. And I've been trying to figure out why. And I got an idea. I got an idea of why. And part of it is because of our military tradition. Because we've been in every war from the very beginning. Started off in 1670 in Charleston. By the way, the Charlestonians, they say Charleston is where the Ashley and the Cooper Rivers joined to form the Atlantic Ocean. That's what they say down there. They're very proud of Charleston. Well, I'm proud of South Carolina, because we are different, and that difference makes a big difference. And speaking of Strom Thurmond, y'all love this. 1996, I was at the National Convention, and Strom Thurmond was sitting on the front row. We were right up front. That's when Bob Dole and Jack Kemp ran. And we were sitting right front. I was party chairman at the time, so I was watching everything go on. And everybody was coming by to say hello to Strom Thurmond. You know, he stepped off the bench, Judge, to the wall. That's right. And they were coming by, and they were shaking hands. And one fella came by and said, "Senator Thurmond, my name is Joe Smith," whatever his name was. He says, "You probably don't remember me, but I met you at some parade somewhere back in 1963. Says the senator. Says, "Well, it's good to see you again." He says, "You don't remember, but my wife was there with me, Sally, and you gave her a great big kiss." And I was wondering, what's the senator going to say about that? He said, "Where is she?" "She's up there in the balcony." He said, "Well, bring on down here and I'll kiss her again." We got great people that come out of this state. And I tell the young people, if you want to be proud of something, you'd be proud of this state. Because we got great people. We have the best natural resources, all the water, the air, the mountains, the ocean. Gracious, we got it all. And one thing I want to do is be sure that our law enforcement is strong. Because if you don't have law enforcement, you don't have anything. If you can't be safe, if you have to worry about that, you can't do anything. And part of that, Tom and Bill, I want to send the world, I want everybody to know that we believe in law enforcement in South Carolina. We will enforce the laws. And you see these other cities, they becoming sanctuary cities, which are a haven for those who breaking the law. If you don't enforce the law, one law, that's a signal that you're not going to enforce others. So I will support legislation and sign it, where South Carolina will never be a sanctuary city. We don't want to have that blight on us. But we've got... I guess that's about one-tenth of what I'd like to say, but I'll quit anyway, because I know you want to go. But I'm proud to have been here with you. And I hope I've made these points, particularly to you young folks. Sometimes it's kind of difficult to communicate, but I've done the best I could. Remember the story about communicating. It's important to communicate, important to learn about this state, to hear what all we've done. So it's a cute little story about the young couple got married. They didn't communicate, didn't talk much at all. He said, "I love you, baby." She said, "I love you too, honey." So let's get married. They got married. Didn't talk much. Moved in, found a little house. They just bought the house, moved in, didn't talk much. Well, mom-in-law moved in with them. Well, they didn't discuss that much, of course. And finally, after about 3 or 4 weeks, the young man looks over his blushing young bride and says, "Baby, don't you think it's about time we find your mama someplace else to live?" She said, "My mama, I thought she was your mama." Always communicate. Communicate. Always, wherever you are. These young people, you be proud of South Carolina, because there's no place like it. And you'll never be in the company of better, stronger people than you are right now. And thank you for letting me.